Hey guys, already lecture 9-3 beyond words. I just want to use this chance or this opportunity to highlight an aspect of language that I don't think the textbook really gave enough play to, especially in this time of pandemic, when I think there's a certain aspect of language that we really need to value, and I'll get there. So let's just jump in. So we'll start by going back to this issue of language and animals. Now remember I started off with that growling dog at the beginning, right? And that dog communicating with you to back off. There is no doubt that animals communicate. No doubt whatsoever. It's really an issue about the complexity of how complex can their communications become. I mean, even when we before we get here, my dog both understands a bunch of words. I was starting to kind of figure out. I didn't really get through it, but she certainly knows the words walk. She knows the word food. She knows the word treat. She knows someone's coming or here. Those words trigger her to go right to the front and look. And I'm sure there's, I bet I should work them out at some point. I bet there's about 20 words that she'll know and recognize when they're said alone. I mean, she certainly knows words like no and come and those commands that we've taught her. She also knows how to communicate back. I mean, we joke at my place that when I forget something that I was supposed to do for her, she sits and stares at me. And I mean, she's a border collie, so they're into staring, but she sits and stares at me. And I can look at her and I'm just like, what? And she's just basically saying, hey, big guy, you're an idiot. You forgot something. And I'm like, what'd I forget? And then she's always right. There's always something that I should have done and have forgotten to do. And so she's able to initiate a conversation, so to speak, a communication. Doing all that with her body language. So we're going to come back to body language. But let's kind of put body language aside for a moment and say, okay, but what about, transmitting a rich thought or a really complex emotion or state. So this became, a question for a while, especially after Jane Goodale had spent time with chimpanzees, and we know chimpanzees are so close to being human. Jane certainly noted all forms of communication amongst the chimpanzees, but again, very simple communication. And so the question was, well, if they were, is their communication simple because that's all they need, and that's all they're able to do, given their limited abilities. What they have to communicate with is their body, and maybe you can only communicate so much richness with your body. Well, that's not totally true, of course. When we get into American Sign Language, which became a big thing, in some of this research, you can use your body to communicate words. You don't have to speak them, right? You can just use your hands, and we know from the deaf community that they have rich, deep conversations using sign language, American Sign Language. And so that was one of the thoughts. Maybe we could teach apes sign language. Or there's another thing we're going to see kind of come into the story, which is something called a picto board. Or another way we can allow them to communicate is have a board with a whole bunch of buttons on it. Buttons that represent different things. And if we teach them what those buttons represent, then they can press the buttons to chain together concepts and words, right? So we can get around there not having the production capability. And will that do anything? And then there's another thing, which is that, I said, maybe in their world they don't need complex communication. Maybe nothing, they don't have like Donald Trump trying to subvert democracy. They don't have those sort of complex political, sociological, or whatever issues. It's a relatively simple life. And maybe there's only certain things you have to communicate, like, oh, there's food over there, or oh, there's danger over there, or hey, you're looking great tonight. these might be the basics of your communication that you need. So researchers based on that thought, okay, maybe enculturation in a human-like world is important. So what if we raise these great apes more like humans? And so, by the way, those of you guys who think that this is what a chimp looks like, this is what a chimp looks like, but this is what a baby chimp looks like. When they grow up, they look like this. They become very big, they become very strong. And that's always a problem with this kind of research because they can get angry. And an angry chimp is a dangerous chimp. And so, you know, we think of them as almost human-like, and they kind of are, and yet they are also, you know, capable of giving full wild animal kind of treatment. So they can be tricky to do research with. Okay. But they did. And there's a number of stories you can see about this. I'm going to recommend this Project NIM as a video you can watch. And I do it for two reasons. It'll feature somebody named Laura Ann Petito. And she was a faculty member at University of Toronto Scarborough for a while. So she was here with us. And so it's just kind of cool to see what she was doing as a very young person. I believe around 18 or 19 in this picture, working with a monkey they named Nim Chimpsky. And it's no coincidence that you've read a bit about Noam Chomsky. Noam Chomsky being the guy that's on the nature side of the language debate, believes that we all have a sort of universal grammar mechanism in our head that allows us all humans to learn language in a powerful way. And so they were kind of curious, well, you know, is it possible that these apes would be capable under the right circumstances? So they started with Nim at a very young age, teaching him sign language. But I mean, the story is just an interesting story because it's set in California in the 60s with a full hippie kind of stuff going on around campuses. And it's a story of a research project that's really kind of a little gone off the rails. So originally, Nim is raised by this couple that are full hippie, pot smoking, partying, whatever, and they let Nim do whatever the heck he wants. And so he kind of runs rampant over their place and takes over everything, and he's having a great time. But they're not teaching him sign language very well, and they're certainly not controlling him very well. And as I told you, chimps get bigger and stronger, and if you've allowed them to run rampant, you're going to be in trouble at some point. And so they had a little bit too much on their hands, and enter Laura Ann Petito at some point, who basically saw what was going on and said, this isn't research. This isn't the way you guys do research. And she really kind of came in as a new research assistant and really kind of buttoned down the hatches and turned it into a real research project. So she spent significant amounts of time with Nim, teaching them sign language, and then just basically seeing where he could get to with this. It's kind of a tragic ending of the story, but again, I'll leave you to kind of see all that and draw your own thoughts about, you know, whether the research should have happened in the first place anyway. It did, and the findings are those ones I kind of left you with at the beginning, that certainly they can learn words, and they can use those words to make requests for things. So using sign language, they can ask for things they want. They can kind of, you know, comment on things. So for example, one of the famous ones, you can look at videos for Coco, the gorilla. And Coco had a kitten that she loved that she named Little Ball. Okay, so she knows the sign for little, she knows the sign for ball, and that became the name of that cat. So she would ask, you know, where Little Ball? And that's the kind of thing they can do, right? They can have basic short questions, commands, comments, I guess. And so there's a video, for example, that I showed during office hours once where Little Ball gets run over and killed, and they have to explain that to Coco. And so with sign language, again, very simplistic, as you'll see in the video, they basically say, you know, Little Ball was hit, Little Ball is dead, Little Ball won't come back. And you see Coco sign things like sad, cry, you know, things like that, and pulling her lip, and so she looks really sad, and then she goes back to her area, her bedroom, for lack of a better term, and cries all night. And so the important part about that is, you know, she clearly understood the communication. And so there is a deep thought being communicated back and forth through sign language. You know, that's certainly capable, but it's again a deep, relatively simple thought. Okay. That seems to be what most animals are capable of. Now, we were talking about this a little bit in office hours, and somebody introduced me to Bunny. So Bunny, look at the thing on the floor here. This is what we call a pictopad, or they go by a number of different names. But the idea is that each of these represents a word, a concept of some sort. And the dog can press these, and by pressing them, they can chain together certain words. And Bunny is apparently a Instagram hit by doing these little, one of the ones I saw is this, the owner's talking to her and she presses a couple things like voice, settle, ouch, or something, which the owners took as her saying, shut up. your voice is hurting my ears. Quiet down a little bit. Now, you know, and very important for that interaction, because it looks like she's pressed these three buttons. And then the owners say, oh, those three buttons. Oh, I think she means this. So there's a whole lot of human interpretation going on, and a whole lot of what we call confirmation bias, that people that want to see their dogs communicating these rich, complex thoughts, will see any attempt as just that. They'll find a way to see it as, oh, that was a rich whatever. And often they may be reading far more into it than is really there. But I suggest you check out some of these videos on Bunny. She's funny. And it's a great chance for you to think about, well, how deeply is she really learning? If you went to this website up here, which I should have just linked, but maybe I'll stick it underneath or something, then you can see the researchers are working on this. They're kind of trying to use this as a technique to see how rich dogs' communications are. I was hopeful from our office hours talks, and I didn't go through it in a lot of detail, but I'd heard some that sounded really impressive. I forget what it was right now, but one of the students told me that, you know, something seemed like a really complex thought that she had thrown out there. If you find it, if you go digging into Bunny archives and you know, feel free to send me what you think is the most impressive of her communication. But this is really just a good example for you to dig in and think about it yourself. Okay, so I mentioned that. I'm going to kind of leave that, the animal language issue, but I again want to go beyond words in other ways. So let's get to the pandemic a little bit. And I'm going to talk about why I think you guys should rediscover the telephone, and why Zoom is horrible. And these two will be interconnected. Okay, so first of all, let me begin. This is a little bit of my, you know, pandemic anxiety spiel. But let me begin by saying, you know, we've heard this term social distancing. But in fact, you don't want to be social distanced during the pandemic. You want to be physically distant from other people. That's the worry, is the virus can spread. So you don't want to be too close physically to somebody. But socially, that's how we deal with stress and grief and anxiety and threat. When we feel any of those negative emotions, we want to connect with our family members. And, you know, if you're watching TV at all in America right now during a pandemic, we're just before Thanksgiving right now, and the numbers are going crazy in the States. And all the medical people are telling people, do not go travel and see your family, because we're already in a surge and you're going to put a surge on top of the surge. And what do we see? Huge travel. Okay, the airports are more full than they've been since the beginning of this pandemic. Everybody feels this need to go and be with their loved ones. That is so natural. It is so human. It's so dangerous right now. So that is not what you should do. You shouldn't get into physical proximity, but you do want to be socially connected. And so how do you do that? And we've been trying to do that with Zooms and all these kinds of things. So I want to make a pitch for the telephone. And sometimes when I'm talking to younger people, just to give you the image, you know, you've all watched Stranger Things, I think. And you remember at times in Stranger Things, you'd see them laying on the bed talking on the phone for hours. That's how we did it in the 80s before the internet. That's sort of how things worked. But there was something to that that I want you to appreciate. And it allows us to kind of talk about language at different levels as we go through. So first of all, when you're having a phone conversation, before even these two points, one of the things I love about phone conversations is we tend to pay attention, right? We pick up the phone, and it's different from staring at a computer or having all this right in front of us. We pick up the phone and we kind of attend to that person. And it's like the rest of the world goes away. I mean, it doesn't have to. Some people talk in a distracted way, but most of us don't. So that's one thing that's already very important. And it's very important because of the second point here. So let's get there. With the actual phone conversation, when you're actually having the discussion, you can think of that discussion as two parts. Part one is the words that are actually being said, and that's the message. Now I'm just distracted talking to you guys. Sorry, that's how bad I'm phone whatever. But my wife is making tea for me, and so I said don't bring it up because I'm recording. I'll come right down. Anyway, so there's the words being said. That's the message. But more important than that is all the nonverbals that are coming out. And they come out because the person is attending, and they show that the person is attending. And that's the important part. So as you're talking, you know, and the person is listening to you, you know, if you say something like, oh, wow, I ran into these people that were just ignoring all the guidelines, and they're probably like, oh, you know, they'll probably make a sound like that. Oh, what the hell's that sound? Well, that sounds like, oh, I know what you're talking about. I hate those people. But that's said in that voice. And what it's saying is I'm connected with you with that emotion. You know, I feel that emotion. There's sighs, there's snickers, there's real LOLs. The real LOL, not the LOL, a real LOL. If you say something to somebody and they laugh out loud, really, and you hear them laugh out loud, you usually snicker and laugh a little yourself. You usually resonate with that. And it's a very positive feeling, and it produces endorphins, and it connects us. Those people we laugh with is really powerful. It's not the same seeing LOL and not even knowing whether the person is just typing that, right? And so this is where the mojo is of a phone. It's in the nonverbals, and they really communicate two things to that person. I'm here and I care about you. That sense that they're listening. And I'm going to come back to this in just a moment, the power of listening. But that's all shown in the nonverbals. That's how we kind of let the person know. Now, if it was a live conversation, we would also be nodding at the right times. We would be making eye contact at certain times. You know, there's other nonverbals that we make in a face-to-face that are also doing that same thing. You know, communicating, caring, communicating that I'm listening, that I'm thinking about what you're talking about. And those are so powerful. And so one of the things I say in a pandemic is have a list of people you talk to every now and then. And again, I recommend the phone. And just come up with an excuse to talk. You know, maybe come up with some TV show and say, let's go both watch that TV show. And then after we watch that TV show, let's talk on the phone about the show. And who cares about the dumb show, really? But it's going to give us an excuse to have something to talk about. And then this is where we'll connect. You know, when we talk about things, those nonverbals that go back and forth, we're both going to hang up the phone and we're both going to feel better. We're going to feel like we connected with somebody we care about. And I actually think, you know, if any of you are feeling lonely, you know, especially with the holidays coming, schedule this into your day. Have an hour every day where you reach out to people and talk to them a little bit on the phone. You know, schedule in some social time. But in this context, so that's good for your mental health. And in this context, I'm really trying to highlight that beyond the words, there's a lot being communicated, and that this is the emotional communication. And it can be really important during things like a pandemic. This is part of the phone thing that I just gave you is a more general thing I want to break out and teach you the power of. Because every time I tell people about this, they say, you know what, I tried that and it works. And I can't believe I haven't been doing it all my life. So I want to be clear about this. The need to be heard and the power of active listening. If we're ever in a dispute with a person, so you know, imagine sometime when you and your parents aren't getting along, or you and your brother and sister, or you and a close friend, and you're having some dispute, an argument, what typically happens is we all want to be heard really, really bad. We all want that other person to understand how we feel. And what we end up doing is expressing this to each other. Here's how I feel. Yeah, well, here's how I feel. Here's how I feel. And we come back and forth at each other. And everyone's talking and nobody's listening. And what happens then is we get frustrated because that person doesn't seem to be hearing what I'm saying. And that makes us more frustrated, more stressed. Sympathetic nervous system gets higher. The argument gets you know, out of control. Here's the critical point. Here's the new skill I want you to try. As soon as you stop talking and clearly listen, things will calm. If you do this trick, hey, I can see you're really upset about this. I'd really like to understand why. Could you explain to me, and you're not being sarcastic, this has to be authentic, this has to be honest, okay? Can you really explain to me sort of what emotions you're feeling right now, and then try to give me a sense of why, like what is it that's making you feel this way? I really want to understand. And if you really want to understand, and you're first of all telling that person, you have the floor. I won't try to tell you how I feel right now. I'm going to shut up about how I feel. And let's look into how you feel. Let's talk about that. So I am now all ears. I'm listening. Tell me how you feel. So one of the things about that, by the way, is you're just, in a way, you're challenging that person. I don't want to put it that way. But you're saying, okay, you've been coming at me with a bunch of emotion. Okay, put that emotion into words. Make me understand. And when a person attempts to put emotions into words, they have to kind of suppress the limbic system where the emotion is coming from and use their frontal lobes. And that in and of itself will calm them down. That will kind of bring back their sympathetic nervous system because they need their rational mind now to explain themselves to you. And you will see, again, when you do this to somebody, that they will just suddenly calm down, suddenly become more in their head. And if they start explaining and you do listen, and maybe even you mine what they're saying a little bit more. Oh, so you're saying that. Oh, so when you think when I'm doing this, this is what that feels to you. If you're authentically trying to understand their perspective, they will not be angry at you. They will be thankful. That's what they want. They want to be heard. And if you're showing that you're hearing them, then you're in a very powerful place. This is what I really recommend is once that you've kind of done this for a while and you know, you've talked about why that person feels, then repeat it back to them. Show them you listened. Actually say, okay, so if I've heard things in the right way, you feel the following ways, and that's because of the following things, and you see them as X, Y, and Z. Okay, so if you can do that and capture accurately what was said, they have been hurt, and they will be like, yeah, and they will in their mind be thankful. Thank you. Thank you for taking the time to understand my perspective. And you now are in a very powerful position because you did take the time to understand them, and you are in a good position now to say, okay, cool. Now can I explain how I feel and why? And now there's what we call social reciprocity, right? You've done them a favor of letting them explain themselves, and so they owe you. And so they're probably likely to say, yeah, sure, go ahead. And you've also modeled this for them, right? You've shown them the power of this approach. And so now you get a chance to express yourself and your position. But now you've both gotten to a rational level, a rational exchange of information, not an emotional one. And this is the single best way. I have a course for police officers. And when I tell them how to calm people around them, that's what I tell them. Listen. Just listen. The power of listening is so, so powerful. Try it. Next time you're having an argument, try it. Tell your parents. I mean, I swear, tell your parents, I would really like to understand why you feel the way you do. They'll be like, what? Kids don't want to understand parents. Try it. Okay? I'm just going to leave that with you. Try it. By the way, you hear about Zoom fatigue. I want to just relate this to nonverbal stuff too. And this is a really blurry picture. Sorry about that. When you're in a Zoom call, it's like the nonverbals are kind of right, but not really right. First of all, you know, some of these people are probably distracted doing other things while they're, and you can tell they're distracted. You can just see from their face there. And this is why you guys don't want to put your cameras on during office hours, which I still think is a mistake. I think you should have them on all the time and get used to that. That makes you attend, right? And if you attend, then you show the right nonverbals. It's back to the phone. They're not going to be quite right in Zoom. They never are. You can't look somebody in the eye. Not really. There's lag sometimes. So sometimes people's expression lags. And as I said, a lot of them are distracted. So they're not giving you back the right nonverbals when they should be. It's not like synchronous, like a phone, because they're not attending. And so we get really tired of talking because the nonverbals aren't right. And they're kind of right. They're half right, but they're not really right. And it can be really taxing on the brain to try, that's used to these things being so well integrated and the nonverbals being such a valuable source of emotional information and connection. And when it's not right, it's sort of the opposite for us. So it just kind of works, you know, badly in that sense. And that's why I think we get really tired after a lot of Zoom meetings. It's just not a human way to communicate. Put the Zoom down, pick up the phone. That's what I say. All right. Couple of other things real quickly on the way out. I know there's interest in this in the class. A number of you have mentioned it. If you've watched the show Lie to Me, the concept of Lie to Me is that this individual is modeled after a psychologist named Paul Ekman. Check out Ekman online. He's a real guy. Of course, the show takes it beyond reasonableness, but here's the Paul Ekman group, and what he's an expert on what's called micro expressions. As we speak, our face is where a ton of nonverbal information comes from. The way that certain muscle groups are, you know, anything that's fear or danger or whatever, we tend to use this. And so if you see, so, you know, maybe when someone's lying, for example, they're always taking a risk of being caught, right? So you might tend to see something happen here. Now, it turns out there's no single thing on a face that you can see where you know someone's lying. And that's what, you know, they kind of take it too far in the show. He's too good at it. But there are combinations of facial features that suggest things like fear. Or danger, a facial reaction to fear or danger, where you can assume maybe that's because they're lying. Could be because of other things they're fearful of as well. But you can really learn about emotions, and you can learn to detect what emotions people are feeling. Now, we all do this regularly. We all, if someone's talking to us, we can sometimes tell when we think they're lying. We don't know why. That's the difference with the Paul Ekman group. We're not sure why. It's just that didn't feel authentic to me. That didn't feel real. You know, I'm not buying your apology. And that is because we are unconsciously kind of reading all these nonverbals. And that's what most of us do. You know, we don't know specifically what it is about that person that makes us think X, Y, or Z. We just think that. Paul has taken the time to find out specifically what it is. And so he has a whole training course where you can learn to read people's faces, which is really interesting. So I just wanted to mention that in case any of you guys want to check that out. A lot of communication happens right here. And the other really cool thing that came from Ekman's work, he and his wife, by the way, both do this, is they found the following thing. They said, you know, we tend to think that if there's some emotion like anger, we feel the emotion and then we wear it. So our face is just reflecting a deeper emotional state. But he and his wife got good at wearing these emotions. They knew them so well, they could put on a sad face or put on an angry face or put on a happy face. And what they found is if you wear an emotion, you then feel that emotion. If you put a sad face on, you start feeling emotionally sad. If you put a happy face on, you start feeling emotionally happy. There's a reciprocal kind of thing where your face actually feeds your emotional state. And so that's, you know, that silly thing that, oh, when you're sad, put on a happy face and get out there. Well, there's something to that. You know, just forcing yourself into a happy sort of countenance and a positive thing will actually make you feel emotionally more positive. Kind of cool. I think I have one more. Yeah. This is just something to mention because I know it's generally of interest to a lot of you, and there's so much research, it's hard to talk about it in any detail. But, you know, we've been talking about language and we've been talking about nonverbal communication, verbal communication, etc. There's a lot of research also on what happens if you're bilingual, if you're proficient in multiple languages. How does that change your existence? Very generally. So there's a lot of people studying bilinguals. And in fact, this is what Lauriane Petitot of Nim Chomsky fame is doing now. So here's a study where they actually suggest that bilingual people see the world differently. They perceive the world differently because of some of the linguistic aspects of the languages they know. So I just wanted to throw that out because I know many of you are bilingual or multilingual. That might be something you'd like to look into and check out a little bit more. There's a lot of cool research being done on that. Okay, so just some other odds and ends with respect to language that I thought I'd throw out there. We're going to kind of move to more of a problem-solving focus in this, where we, you know, we think sometimes people use language to solve problems. So that's where we're kind of going on next. But there we go. There's our language thing. Alrighty. Later, guys. Bye-bye.